Samuel Hendricks said a top question. He said, why do we have so few storytellers? That's a really excellent question. You know, Sam, that's the question. Evan Sayat wrote a book called The Kindergarten of Eden about the difference between liberal intelligence and conservative intelligence. And he said that conservatives have practical intelligence, but that liberals have rhetorical intelligence. In order to be modern liberal, a progressive, you have to have a belief in something that isn't real. This Loch Ness Monster thing, I think, was a pretty good analogy. If you're going to be a progressive, you have to believe that this current society and capitalism and all this other stuff has to be destroyed to make way for this utopia of equality, where there is no more war, there's no more inequality, there's no more sickness, no more anything. You have to believe in this stuff. And the kind of people that believe in those kind of fantasy worlds are the kind of people that go on to make excellent writers, actors, directors, musicians, by and large. It's pretty much true. And I'm one of them. You know, I mean, people ask me why I got, I think there's a question later on directly. Here it is. I'll just answer it now from Jacob Belchek. I'll tie these two together. What inspired you to be the storyteller you are today? I'll tell you what inspired me, Jacob. Losing my ability to be a fighter pilot is what inspired me to be a storyteller today, because when I realized I couldn't fly in space for real, the only thing I could think of was making movies about flying in space. It was as close as I could get. When you look at how movies are made and the kind of people who make them, think about a movie like any one of those John Hughes movies, like 16 Candles. You've seen this story 1,000 times, right? Where it's about a high school nerd, and there's this beautiful girl that he loves, and she's in love with this big, dumb, stupid football player. But through the course of his personality, and after, you know, get knocked down and get back up again, just through the charm and the character and the kind of wit and the cleverness and the soul, he wins the girl from the brutish guy, and they live happily ever after. I've seen that story 1,000 times. And when I was a kid watching those, I thought, awesome. And you know what? That has never happened. Ever. It's never happened. The nerdy guy has never taken away the cheerleading head cheerleader or the homecoming queen from the football captain. I'm about to get 600 different examples from people telling me, no, this happened to me. I'll be prepared to deal with those as the exception to the rule, but I'm telling you, it doesn't happen. So why do these stories get made? And I'll tell you why they get made, because I was that guy. They get made because the nerdy guys who never did get the head cheerleader in school, who lost the homecoming queen to the football captain, grow up to be screenwriters. And they grow up to start telling stories. And what they do universally is, through their writing, they get to rewrite their own childhood and give it the happy ending that they wanted. That's how it works. That's why people get into this business as writers and filmmakers and directors. More often than not, they do it to tell a story, to change the ending that they wanted. And when you see movies like Dave or any of these, you know, like The Candidate or any of these Robert Redford movies or, you know, Norma Rae or any of this stuff, what it is progressives who are angry at the world go out there and remake the world in the kind of ending that they want. And that is a very powerful drive, I'm here to tell you. That desire to make the world come out the way you want it is overwhelming. For me, with Aurora, which I've been working on for 10 years now, I'm making that movie because I want to show people we could do this right now. I want to change reality. I want to tell a story to change reality. That's why I'm doing it. So that's why we have such few good storytellers, Samuels, because most conservatives are pretty happy, and we've got a family, and we've got, you know, religion, or we've got a cause, or we go to work, or whatever. We're not unhappy. And by the way, I'll add this, and I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but my experience has been that just about everybody in show business, one or two examples that I actually can't think, yeah, I can think of one. Jeremy Boring is the only example that comes to mind, but just about everybody else has pretty messed up childhoods, and almost everybody in Hollywood has major problems with dad images, you know, big authority issues, and they're rebelling against authority, or they're looking for the love they never got. I'm not the first person ever to announce, you know, that a lot of people who are just absolutely have to be actors, or people who are looking for applause because they didn't get any attention when they're kids, and they just like a sponge, and they just soak it up. They're a giant black hole of need. Writers want to write the ending that didn't happen to them. They want to write a story where things came out the way they wanted to instead of the way that it actually did. Actors want the attention they didn't get when they were young, and so on and so on and so on. So it's not that there's not any conservative storytellers so much as the people who have a burning desire to deal with this fantasy world naturally gravitate to a fantasy political philosophy. And when I was the most liberal I ever was, I was surrounded by actors, and I believed that Ronald Reagan was a crazy old man who was an idiot, a sub 80 IQ idiot who was going to get us all killed. And I believed that because everybody else believed it. I didn't know anything about Ronald Reagan. I didn't know anything about what he wrote or no. I just agreed with everybody else. And that's why we can go and turn these people, because they've never heard the message. See, that's why I want to get this video done.